Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia, like anything else that ends in emia, has to do with the blood. And the K, if you remember from the periodic table, has to do with potassium. So we're going to talk about high potassium in the blood. And that, generally speaking, is greater than 5.0. But of course, the higher it goes, the worse the symptoms can become. So the normal range for potassium is about 3.5 to 5.0. This is an extremely well-regulated system. Potassium has to be very well-regulated in the blood. And the reason is because the conduction system in the heart specifically, and then also in the muscle, depends heavily on potassium going through the membrane. And so the conductivity to potassium is very high, so that if there is a problem with the concentration of potassium outside the cell, it's really going to affect the depolarization of those cells. And so potassium abnormalities are really going to hit the heart quite hard and cause arrhythmias. And that's why the body is so keen on protecting the level of potassium. So we're going to talk about the causes of hyperkalemia, the manifestations of hyperkalemia, and the treatment of hyperkalemia. Okay, so let's talk about the causes. The first cause is excessive tissue release, or transcellular shifts. Okay, so you can think about, for instance, diabetes. Remember, what happens in diabetes is there's a lot of glucose around the cells. So you've got a cell here, and you've got glucose outside the cell. And that causes water to leave the cell and for it to do something called crenation. It shrinks, basically. And when that happens, the potassium concentration, which is already high in the cell, is actually going to go up. And this causes leakage of potassium outside the cell. And the fact in diabetes is insulin, which especially in type 1 diabetics is rare, insulin is responsible for putting potassium back inside the cell. Okay, so that's an important note, is that insulin causes potassium to shift back into the cell. And in a patient with diabetes, the glucose is high. That causes eventually potassium to leak outside the cell. Since there's no insulin, it cannot be put back inside the cell. Another corollary to this is something called HH, or hyporeninemic hypoaldosteronism. Okay, so that's hyporenin. The renin is the thing that should be stimulating the adrenal cortex to make aldosterone. But as a fact that it doesn't, you get hypoaldosterone. Now remember, aldosterone works on the distal convoluted tubule, right about there. And remember what it does, it causes potassium excretion and sodium reabsorption at the distal convoluted tubule. So if you don't have enough aldosterone being secreted from the zona glomerulosa of the adrenal cortex, you're going to get an accumulation of potassium inside the serum. The reason why I bring these up together is this hyporenic hypoaldosteronism can be seen together with diabetes. So that's just one cause of hyperkalemia. The next cause is kind of obvious, and that's just increased intake of potassium. So you got to kind of know what has potassium in it. And some of the things that have potassium in it are salt substitute. So instead of having the cation sodium, that has the cation potassium. The other thing that you can see is the excessive intake in renal failure. These people who are in renal failure typically are the ones that are on salt substitutes, and this potassium cannot be cleared. The other one that we kind of talked about, if the zona glomerulosa of the adrenal cortex is not secreting aldosterone, is you will see adrenal failure. If it is a problem with the pituitary not stimulating the adrenal cortex, the aldosterone still is secreted in sufficient amounts that you may not see hyperkalemia. However, if there is a direct attack on the adrenal cortex where antibodies are destroying all three layers, then your aldosterone levels will be low and you will see hyperkalemia in addition to all of the other things that you would see in adrenal failure, for instance, hypoglycemia, hyponatremia, and metabolic acidosis. The last thing that you would see is, of course, in a potassium-sparing diuretic. So some examples of this would be spironolactone or amiloride. Incidentally, other medications that could also increase your potassium are things that can also affect shifting of the cells or affect the other areas that we've already talked about. The ones that you should know about are ACE inhibitors. So remember, ACE inhibitors inhibit ACE, which is angiotensin converting enzyme, which is in the lungs, and that's going to affect the ability to make aldosterone. The other thing that can do this is beta blockers. We'll talk about treatment with beta agonists later, but beta blockers can affect shifting of potassium and actually cause it to go out of the cell. Another cause is something that's interesting, and it's called pseudo hyperkalemia. And it's really based on the fact that all cells in the body have high concentrations of potassium in it. So where you see this is if you have a patient with many cells that are drawn in a test tube. So if you have marked leukocytosis or thrombocytosis, so they'll be in platelets as well, and you get coagulation in the test tube that causes these cells to lyse and release their potassium. When you put this through the laboratory equipment, you're going to see elevated potassium. And they'll sometimes tell you if they see this, and they'll say hemolysis. And if you get hyperkalemia and they say, by the way, hemolysis was 3+, then you may have to take that with a grain of salt, so to speak, and maybe repeat the test again to see and redraw the blood, actually, because if once there's hemolysis, you really need to get a new blood draw on that specimen. Okay, let's talk about manifestations of hyperkalemia. What would happen really has a lot to do with the heart. And the reason is because the conductance of potassium in the depolarization of cardiac conduction cells is quite high, such that potassium is always leaving the cells. And so what happens is you have a positive charge leaving the cell. Okay, what's that going to do? That's going to generally make the inside of your cell negative. And that's exactly what we see here. Down to close to negative 90 millivolts, you've got this negative. The problem here is that when you have an abundance of potassium in the solution, in the serum, in other words, when you have hyperkalemia, these potassium ions are not going to leave the cell as quickly. And so whereas you would have a very negatively charged cell, it's not going to be so negatively charged. You're going to get something called depolarization. So these cells are more excitable. And as a result of that, not only is it depolarized, but instead of having a nice sharp uptick, it's going to come up more slowly. And the repolarization is going to be somewhat dampened. Okay? As a result of that, when you look at a nice QRS complex, instead of having a discrete P wave QRST, what you're actually going to see is the P wave is almost going to be non-existent. The R wave is going to sort of come up slightly. You're going to have this S depression and then this T wave. and it's almost going to look sinusoidal. And of course, the higher the potassium and the faster the potassium has gotten high, the more quickly you're going to see this. If somebody is camping out at 5 to 6 and they go up to 7, you're not going to see those changes because the body has a chance to adjust, perhaps. But if someone is living in the 3s to 4s and then jumps up to 7, you're more likely to see that. The first thing that you'll see with hyperkalemia is you'll actually see peak T waves. Okay? That's the first thing that you'll see. And then eventually you'll just see this thing go sinusoidal. So it'll just kind of go like this and you'll just go into cardiac arrest. So what should you know about manifestations? You will have depolarization due to low potassium conductance, lower than normal. And then after that, you'll get hyperpolarization due to inactivated sodium channels. You'll have this reduced phase zero velocity, okay? And you'll have decreased membrane excitability. And then you'll get increased potassium conductance and accelerated repolarization. Okay? So what should you know? What would they actually test you on a test about hyperkalemia? I think the thing that they would test you on is, number one, know that peaked T waves is the first sign that you'll see. Number two, if it eventually gets high enough, you'll get this sinusoidal wave. And number three, hyperkalemia in general is going to affect the heart. And all of this is an emergency. Now, in the next video, we're going to talk about the treatment of hyperkalemia and some of the reasons why this treatment works.